restroom the church last Sunday. That was in the fellowship hall. So at the moment, those restrooms are out of order. We hope to get the restrooms cleaned up. They're usable right now, but they're not clean. So we hope to get those cleaned up this week, and they'll be back in order on next Sunday. For now, there's a restroom in the nursery. There's one back here behind me, and if you don't mind stairs, there's one upstairs that you can use. That leads into the second part of it. Until we get things cleaned up and back in order, we probably won't be able to have our Wednesday night suppers until that happens. So we don't know how long that will be. But we will start those back up as soon as we can use the space again. And we're glad that the damage doesn't seem to be too bad. It's just going to take some time to clean up and repair. Let's continue in worship together. If you will, stand and join me in our prayer. I'll read the light print if you will respond with the quote. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things.
The Lord has made his salvation known, and he revealed his righteousness to the nations.
Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music.
Make peace to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing.
With trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Let us worship together. here this morning, I wonder if their names should be added to our list.
I just, again, he just needs prayers, he's, they're not getting good news, like, he's been taking medicine for his cold and it's not healing at all. He might even have that cold, I mean, like, removal of some of his cold. He's getting ill.
He's on here already.
Yeah, he is, but yeah, it just didn't get good news, like, the whole business.
I've been asked to make you aware of the death in the community of Roseanne, now to go find him. TJ Graves passed away this past week, so we, his church family, extend sympathy to his family. Also, Mark and Darlene, Mark had knee surgery this past week and he's got a lot of pain right now. Darlene's not feeling all that well at the moment either. So some prayers for healing and recuperation for both of them. Are there others?
Please add my brother-in-law Bill Lamb. He's in the hospital down at Jeff with pneumonia in both lungs. And one lung is completely not working. And some other issues also.
Are there others? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Good and gracious God, we're thankful to gather in this space on another new year. God, as we break into this new year, this community of faith celebrates 150 years here in this place. God, if that's not a testament to your faithfulness, I don't know what is. And each time we gather for worship, it's our tradition to turn to our prayer list and to lift up the people that we love and that we cherish, because we know that you are a faithful God. We know that you are capable of healing. You're a God of love and of peace. God, so we lift these names up to you, both the names that have just been added today and those that have been there for quite some time. We know that all things in their due time are your business. God, and you're in the business of hearing our prayers. God, forgive us where we fail. For it's your name we pray. Amen. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Thank you. are gonna help me out this morning. I already told them, so they have the answers prepared. But as we enter into this new year, and each of us will inevitably add another year to our lives, we get further and further away from the age of a child. And I think we forget things along the way about being a child, and we forget that, you know what, life is worth living, and they can teach us a lot. So this morning, I've asked them to think of one of their favorite things and to share it with us. So can either of you tell me what your favorite thing is? You like having Nerf battles with your friends? That's a pretty good one. What about you? Family and friends? See, I think we go through life and we go day to day. We go to work, get up, make our coffee, get in the car, go to work. And we forget about the things that we go to work for, like our family and our friends. That's a perspective that they haven't lost yet, and they can teach us about that. And so we're glad they're here, just not just because we get to see them every week, but because they contribute to our community as well, don't they? We're glad that you're here. We wouldn't have candles lit or a cross here without you. We're glad that you're here to help us. And we know that you contribute to this community just as much as I do or anyone else does. So we want you to know that we love you, I love you, and everyone here is a part of raising you, and you contribute to us, you're valuable to us as well. So this is for you. This is for you. Let's pray. Gracious God, we're thankful for the ability to look upon the people among us who may be younger than us in years, but who have a perspective that we've long since forgotten. God, we know that you're faithful and that you love us, and you've given us these precious young people to teach us, to remind us of things that we've long since put away. So God, forgive us when we forget the things that we ought not forget, and let us always remember the value that each person brings to this community. God, forgive us where we fail you. It's in your name we pray.
Thank you.
scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Revelation, and it's chapter 4. It says this: "After this I looked, and there in heaven a door stood open. And the first voice, which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, 'Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this.' At once I was in the Spirit, and there in heaven stood a throne, with one seated on the throne. And the one seated there looks like jasper and carnelian, and around the throne is a rainbow that looks like an emerald. Around the throne are 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones are 24 elders dressed in white robes, with golden crowns on their heads. Coming from the throne are flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. And in front of the throne burn seven flaming torches, which are the seven spirits of God. And in front of the throne there is something like a sea of glass, like crystal. Around the throne and on each side of the throne are four living creatures full of eyes in front and back. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with a face like a human, and the fourth living creature like a flying eagle. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and inside. Day and night, without ceasing, they sing, 'Holy, holy, holy, the Lord God, the Almighty, who was and is to come.' And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to the one who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall before the one who is seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created.'" This is the word of God. Worship is something that we do every week in a multitude of ways. Our worship isn't restricted to Sunday mornings or Wednesday evenings either. Worship is something we do each and every day, both passively and actively. We do it when we aren't even aware of it. Worship is a way of life, and we all live it. In fact, I would say that worship is the way of life. To live is to worship, and to worship is to live. Now, obviously, if that is the case, then not all worship is all that great. Because, well, we aren't all that great sometimes. Sometimes our worship is atrocious and offensive. But at its best, worship is supposed to reflect God back out into his creation. Worship paints an honest and pure picture of the creator of the universe. And when our worship does that, it is holy and pleasing to God. It's an offering that God is happy to accept. And so, for the next few weeks that we're gathered here together as we kick off this new year, I want us to dive into the most basic of our traditions: the way we worship. Sometimes tradition can develop a bad reputation, and sometimes tradition deserves it. As much as we like to think otherwise, doing something because it's the way we've always done it simply isn't a good reason to do much of anything. It turns out that better ways of doing even the things that must be done are appearing all the time. It's all too easy for us to get caught up on tradition, because it's what we know. It's what's familiar to us. And the familiar is considerably more comfortable than the new and the unknown. But don't worry, that's not to say that tradition is bad. Tradition is a powerful thing that can draw us together as a community of faith. It helps us build and share our identity and our sense of community. It links us together across time as well. As generations come and go, our traditions bind us together with our ancestors. And there's a certain power in the idea of knowing that our children and grandchildren participate in a Christmas Eve candlelight service every year, for example. Tradition is nothing to poke fun of. As a broad category, Tradition isn't old and out of style. Every new generation accepts, rejects, and modifies the traditions that they inherit from the generations before them. And your generation did the same thing. The reason that we're taking the time to look at our tradition is simple. Tradition is good if and only if it has meaning. Tradition becomes a burden when it no longer carries meaning for its devotees. You can all think of examples both inside and outside the church which simply didn't matter as much to you as it did to your parents or your grandparents. Perhaps your grandparents would be red in the face to see some of you attending church in pants, of all things. Why in the world would you enter God's house in pants? Your grandparents may have really cared about that. And whether we were ever able to understand it, wearing your finest clothes to church on Sunday was really meaningful for them. For some of our ancestors, maybe they only had two basic outfits, work clothes and Sunday clothes. And God deserved better than their dirty, tattered overalls. Can you see how tradition gains and loses its meaning over the years? You probably have more than two outfits in your closet. I promise I'll get to the text in just a minute. I really will. But for now, let's take a look at our tradition of worship. This is what we're going to be doing for the next few weeks. As we begin this next new year, we're going to comb through our bulletin and talk about most, if not all, the portions of our standard Sunday worship service. As we go, I want to help us both better understand and perhaps even rediscover the rich meaning that's embedded in this communal worship that we have each week. A healthy tradition of sound communal worship should strengthen our bond with God, strengthen our bond with one another, and inspire us to live more faithfully and with more worshipful lives day in and day out. So today I want us to reflect on the opening portions of our Sunday services. You probably know that our services begin with a prelude, bringing in the light and the call to worship. Those three things happen almost every week and for good reason. They aren't just time fillers or space fillers in a worship service. They do three things for us. First, they awaken our awareness to the presence of God. I think we all know that God is always with us. It's become something of an assumption for us as we go through life. But that's the thing about a faithful God. He's always there. The question isn't whether God is there, but rather whether we are conscious of it. And that matters. So as the chimes play each Sunday and the prelude begins, we're drawn into our awareness of God's presence here, in this place, with us. Our conversations begin to slow down, almost instinctually. We begin to focus on the music and the presence that it represents. And we watch solemnly as the light is brought into our worship space. As the candles are brought to life here upon the altar, it's a visual reminder of the presence of God. There's a reason that the candles burn until our time of worship is over. These candles, like the prelude music, stir up our awareness of God's presence, not just in this space, but in our lives that we live outside of these walls. And speaking of tradition, the flame has long been associated with the presence of God. You remember that Moses encounters God in a burning bush. The Israelites follow a pillar of fire in the night as they escape Egypt. The prophet Elijah calls down fire on a sacrifice that the prophets of a foreign god could not ignite. And probably most memorable to us as Christians, the flaming tongues of Pentecost signify the presence of the Holy Spirit among those gathered in Jerusalem. So each Sunday, lighting the candles on our own altar is intended to participate in that long tradition of recognizing the presence of God in our lives. And right on the heels of bringing the light, we tend to all participate in a call to worship, just like we did this morning. This is the first act of worship in which we all collectively participate. And it brings us to the second thing that the opening portions of our worship services do. Not only do they awaken our awareness of God's presence, true worship is dependent upon the proper orientation. They orient us toward God's presence. As we draw near to God, and God draws near to us, our focus dissolves from ourselves and recenters on the Creator of the universe. A call to worship is meant to point our hearts in the direction of the divine. It prepares us for the rest of our time together in worship. Even this morning, when we gathered for worship as the music started playing, our awareness of the presence of God was kindled in the way that you kindle a fire in your stove. And our hearts were drawn into the mood of worship. It's a moment for us to take a step back from the plethora of problems, issues, worries, and anxieties that life has to offer outside of these walls. Even walls just over here. And then it allows us to step into a space that we call sanctuary for a reason. You see, a sanctuary is more than simply a physical space. A sanctuary is a place of worship, and worship entails a certain security from the troubles of the world around us. This is supposed to give us a breath of fresh air each week. So when we take our time to orient ourselves to the presence of God, we become less distracted. Our worship becomes more focused and meaningful. That's why we begin our services together in this way. We prepare ourselves to commune with God. We plug into the power of the divine and we allow ourselves to be recharged. You know, worship is a two-way street. It's clear to us that the object of our worship is God. We thank and praise God for all he has done in our world as a primary function. But the byproduct of worship is energy for the soul. There are some degrees of tired that enough sleep can't fix. Proper worship should energize us in a way that no other action can. Sleep recharges the body. But worship is what powers the soul, the very essence of our being. It brings us peace, and it grounds us in love, in faith, and in hope. Sleep can't do that for us. The opening portions of worship traditions kindle our awareness of the divine. They orient us toward the divine presence. And finally, they serve as an invitation for us to enter into a holy space. They invite us to enter into God's presence and to worship together in spirit and truth. It's important for us to take the opportunities we are given to become or to come into God's presence, to be oriented toward his presence and to enter into it. These are very intentional and very meaningful actions we use as we worship together each week. That's what makes them traditions worth practicing. I mentioned earlier that traditions come in many shapes and sizes, but the value of any tradition is tied directly to the meaning that practicing them provides to the community. This tradition that we talked about this morning is deeply meaningful. And it has been from the very beginning of the worship of God. That's the very scene that we see described in the book of Revelation. As we take a peek into the throne room of heaven, we find a worship scene that may involve beings entirely different from us or anything we've ever seen. But we worship God in much the same way. Their awareness of God's presence is kindled. They are oriented toward God's presence, and they enter into that presence with thanksgiving and praise. praise. It's a scene of corporate worship in the heavenly space. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but as a sneak peek of coming weeks, the Lord's Prayer calls for God's kingdom to come exist here with us. And when it does, the prayer says that God's will shall be accomplished here on earth, just as it is in heaven. We participate and anticipate at the same time that beautiful day when we enter into worship together. It's a small image here in this room of what happens in heaven. So I hope the coming weeks can revitalize the value of our traditions, especially as they relate to our time of worship together. I hope they help us revive the deep meaning our tradition provides for us. And finally, I hope the coming weeks restore a sense of peace that we're often tempted to resist. Worship is for us a chance to be recharged by the presence of God, but it's primarily an opportunity to recognize God's work in the world. Remind us that God is never far away. He is here, even here this morning, among us, even people just like us. Would you pray with me? God of grace and of peace, we enter into this space each week with varying degrees of ease. Some of us can't wait to fly through the door, and some of us can't wait to fly out. Some of us don't need a lot of motivation, and some of us all but kick and scream our way into this space. We share our hearts this morning knowing that we have all shown the full spectrum of attitudes toward worship. But we recognize this morning that worship, especially worship as a community of faith, is necessary for life. So as we go from this place today, O God, may we go with hearts full of meaning and peace, for you are the author of both. We love you, Lord. Amen. passion of the Son and the power of the